Deputy Chairperson of the bank and also the chairperson of the audit oversight of the bank. With the board members here present, members of the press, welcome to the Reserve Bank, including our senior management at the bank. It's a great pleasure to welcome you this afternoon. Thanking you for coming. Let me immediately go to the business of the day and present our monthly report statement. Yourselves to digestion and of course to give the necessary critique of the necessary statement. The monthly report statement is issued in terms of the section 46 of the Reserve Bank Act, chapter 2215, which requires the bank to issue a statement containing a description of the monetary policy to be followed by the bank during the next 6 months in the assessment of the reasons for those policies and the statement of principles that the bank proposes to follow in implementation of the policy. It's also supposed to make evaluation of the monetary policy measures that we did in the previous 6 months. This year's statement comes at a time when the country and the economy is experiencing renewed hope and confidence brought in by the new economic dispensation, following the formation of the new leaner cabinet by His Excellency President Edim Nagawa in November 2017. This renewed hope and confidence would need to be supported by going back to basics, to restore business confidence, and to foster discipline within the national economy. Accordingly, this monetary policy statement seeks to buttress this confidence trajectory by putting in place measures that will gradually liberalize the foreign currency market in order to indicate that the country is indeed open for business. The bank is continuing to make concerted efforts to address cash shortages, which are a direct reflection of the tight foreign exchange macroeconomic environment that is exacerbated by the transmission impact of the persistent fiscal deficit on the financial sector. Addressing this current macroeconomic imbalance requires a sharp rise in foreign exchange reserves and an improvement in the fiscal balance. It is against this background that interventions by the bank in the foreign exchange market through nostril stabilization facilities have generally assisted the economy to meet the ever-growing demand for foreign exchange, and in doing so, stabilizing parallel market activities and sustaining the financing of critical imports such as fuel, electricity, cash imports, medicines, essential products, mention a few. In addition, policy interventions to promote exports continue to bear fruit, as evidenced by the continued narrowing of the current account deficit. It is in this regard that Zimbabwe's current account balance is now within the national best practice range and also consistent with the macroeconomic convergence of SADC and COMESA. This notwithstanding, the country's high import dependency continues to exert pressure on foreign exchange resources, thus fueling parallel market activities for foreign exchange. This economic situation is compounded by the growing fiscal deficit, which remains the major driver of increased deposits or money supply in the banking sector, which creates foreign currency liquidity shortages in the economy and causing inflationary pressures through domestic money emission on the largest platform. Opening up of the economy to business is therefore the most sustainable cure for the major challenges the economy is facing. Opening Zimbabwe for business means attracting investment, foreign and domestic, that is required to increase production, jobs, fiscal space, exports, and eventually the happiness index for all Zimbabweans. It moves the economy beyond stabilization. Opening up the economy also calls for local businesses to improve on their efficiencies and competitiveness in order to brace for competition from foreigners as the economy is open. The bank is convinced that by opening up the economy for business, the country has struck the right chord for the sustainable transformation of the economy. It is in this optimistic context that the bank is coming up with measures to gradually open the foreign currency market in order to restore investor confidence within the economy under the new narrative that Zimbabwe is open for business. Specifically, this statement presents the following, or attempts to address the following. One, to further promote the use of mobile and electronic payment system, the plastic money, enhance the use of the local generated RTGS money to generate more exports, improving the foreign currency market, enhancing rewards to exporters and reducing cost of doing business of exporting, providing generators of foreign currency, assurances of ease of access to foreign currency, enhancing foreign currency retention thresholds, enhancing local stabilization facilities to provide assurances to foreign exchange earners for foreign availability and to meet the import requirements of essential commodities. We are also exploring to improve ease of access to productive sector facilities that we put in place, addressing the needs of the diasporans, reinforcing the area skills and re-engaging program, providing guidance on the continuation of the multi-currency system, providing guidance on the presidential amnesty on externalized assets and funds, and lastly, to provide update on the acceptability of 99-year leases as collateral at the banks. This mandatory policy statement also makes an evaluation of the measures that taken by the bank in 2017. There are quite a number. I should just summarize them before I go to the policy measures specifically. The intervention by the bank in the foreign exchange market through drawdown from the NOSFO stabilization facilities amounted to $1.1 billion during 2017. This immensely assisted to stabilize the forex market and to sustain financing of critical imports such as fuel, electricity, medicines, fertilizers, agrochemicals, soya crude oil for cooking oil, cash imports and raw materials for industry. Drawdown from these facilities together with the utilization of bond notes in the market of $290 million as at end of December 2017 went a long way to stabilize shortages of cash in the economy. The worst could have happened, especially in September 2017, had not been the positive impact of these NOSFO stabilization facilities on the economy. A good number of firms in the manufacturing sector, such as manufactured products, the food products, packaging, fertilizers, agrochemicals, have continued to benefit from the NOSFO stabilization facilities. The performance and impact of the export incentive scheme has been very positive on the economy, We've arranged the ZUA way, the $200 million initially and the $300 million for which is monetized through bond notes. This has worked very well. And since since inception in 2016 with the incentive scheme, the export incentive has been enhanced, and to the extent that exports have grown by 36% in 2017 from 2.8 billion to 3.8 billion in 2017. That's a 36% growth rate. During the same period, the export incentive payouts amounted to $297 million since May 2016. And of that $297 million, the bond notes issued as at the end of 2017 were $290 million. That's what is the market. Together with the $1.1 billion that we took or borrowed from the North Central Brazilian facilities, has gone a long way to ensure that the market remains liquid. It might not be as liquid as you want, but it's liquid to sustain the economy going forward. On the Afreximbank backed market facility, the AfTrades, as at the end of 2017, were drawn down trades of amounting to 399.5 million. The service bond that we issued since starting September last year, for 3 months, October to December, the bond note, which is a 7% tax-free corporate bond note, so bonds, service bonds, we have raised as at end of December last year $165 million. That's been very positive. Usage of plastic money has been on the high growth trajectory. It's been a fantastic quantum leap, unprecedented increase in the values and volumes of transactions that have gone through this platform. You want to know that the growth has been phenomenal, with out of $97.5 billion of transactions in this economy, from 1 billion transactions. So the volume, 1 billion transactions, value, $97.5 billion. Out of that 97.5 billion, 96% was plastic money. And that's not a small change. So it means that Zimbabweans, we want to thank Zimbabweans for accepting the usage of plastic money. They've been fantastic, they've been good, and we that is in volume terms. If you look at the volume terms, just give you an indication. Mobile banking alone, before you talk about the point of sale machines, mobile banking only in 2017, where the transactions more than 754 million transactions. Value at $18 billion. In terms of volume, it accounted for 75%. And the POS machines, 21%. So if you notice, you find that the plastic money has been very, very useful in Zimbabwe. What does it do? It reduces the need for carrying cash. It preserves foreign currency for foreign payments. It decongests the banks from queues. That's why we like plastic money, because we're using foreign currency. You notice in this document, this mandatory statement, that all the graphs, all the numbers are given. And in terms of financial inclusion, we are quite happy that the economy is also taking this on board positively. So the financial inclusion, we have the depth of which is also gone down into the roots of the economy. In terms of our facilities that we have put in place, today more than $130 million have been drawn down from the special facilities that we've put in place. We've got things like the gold support facility, the export finance facility, gold culture facility, and tobacco export import facility, so input support facility. To date, we've drawn down all those issues, 180 million, of which the highest was for gold at $74 million, followed by tobacco at $28 million. So the facilities are working, but we need to ensure that the easy of access to these facilities. It is in this context, in the background, that the following measures to enhance financial stability and promote business confidence in the economy are presented to yourselves and being pronounced here as follows. In order to enhance business confidence and credibility under the Zimbabwe is open for business, supportive monetary and fiscal measures are essential to walk the talk, to improve the monetary environment, which is characterized by tight foreign exchange, tight foreign exchange liquidity. The panacea for this challenge of tight foreign currency liquidity is to increase production, exports, foreign direct investment, loans, diaspora remittances, and put in place measures to protect investor funds, so that at the end of the day, we can get more foreign currency. In line with this narrative, and to enhance ease of doing business in the economy, the following measures are being put in place with immediate effect to gradually liberalize the foreign currency market and promote business confidence. One, enhancing the Nostro stabilization facilities and ring fencing foreign currency inflows. The bank is enhancing the Nostro stabilization facilities by $400 million to support the following. A, to provide assurances that international remittances and individual foreign currency inflows received through normal banking channels are available for use when required by the owners. B, to meet the foreign exchange requirement for the importation of essential products that we've already mentioned. Three, refining the operation of the portfolio investment fund by ensuring that all portfolio investment inflows are ring-fenced to meet the portfolio investment outflows, which shall be processed by giving priority to capital before capital appreciation and profits and dividends. This policy measure is necessary to augment the current $5 billion that has been provided in the fund as a seed capital, and to further provide assurances to investors that Zimbabwe is indeed open for business. So we are arranging the Nostro stabilization facilities to ensure that those three principles or those three uses are achieved. Two, provision of investment guarantees to protect investor funds. The bank is working with the African Export Import Bank, Afreximbank, to put in place a $1.5 billion facility that is earmarked for the provision of guarantees in the sum of $1 billion to investment coming into the country and for liquidity support of up to $500 million. Such guarantees and liquidity support are necessary to protect investors' funds from country risk, and in doing so, enhancing investor confidence. Three, provision of 7% tax-free savings bonds on non-resident transferable funds. In order to provide return on remittable funds currently held as non-resident transferable funds at banks, that cannot immediately be remitted as a result of the shortage of foreign currency. Such funds can now be invested in the tax-free savings bonds at a corporate rate of 7%. This compensation process is necessary to assure investors of returns on their idle funds secretly banked. Four, enhanced export incentive scheme for horticulture, cotton, macadamia, and gold. The economy's foreign currency inflows are on a positive trajectory, largely on account of increasing export receipts that grew by 36% in 2017 from the 2016 level. It is therefore important to sustain this momentum for increased foreign currency inflows. Accordingly, the current export incentive scheme that is funded by bond notes shall be maintained to promote export competitiveness at the current thresholds. The scheme, which was adjusted to 12.5% for tobacco growers starting this year, shall be tweaked to 10% for horticulture, cotton, macadamia, and gold producers. Five, increasing tobacco and gold support facilities. In order to enhance foreign currency inflows from tobacco and gold production, the tobacco input finance scheme has been increased from $28 million dispersed in 2017 to $70 million, while the gold support facility has been increased from $74 million dispersed to 255 entities to $150 million. Financing tobacco and gold exports, such as horticulture, mining, tourism, etc., using LTGS funds seated at the banks, is beneficial for generating foreign currency for the economy. We are leveraging on the LTGS funds. Further, in line with the tobacco finance order, deserving tobacco merchants shall be granted authority by the bank to use LTGS money to purchase tobacco from the ocean floors. This dispensation shall also apply to cotton merchants who deserve to be given this dispensation. Six, establishment of offshore financial service center. The bank is currently working on a legal framework to operationalize the establishment of an offshore financial service center within the context of the Special Economic Zones program. The legal framework is built on providing investors with the supportive policy environment and guidelines to pursue various investment options in the financial service center. We want the Zimbabwe to be the Macau of the SADC, to be a place where foreigners can invest their funds and able to get the money back to their administrations. Seven, purchase of gold for value addition. The jewelry industry remains key in promoting value addition, which is in sync with government policy on mineral beneficiation. In order to enhance the gold industry contribution to this value addition objective, priority shall be given to export-oriented jewelry manufacturers, where the jewelry manufacturer shall retain 100% of the foreign currency generated from the value-added component for use in their business operations. Approval to jewelry manufacturers to meet local demand shall be availed not more than 3 kgs per quarter through the Fidelity Printers and the Finance, under a properly monitored arrangement to guard against abuse of this facility. Eight, enhancing the ease of access to productive sector facilities. The bank has put in place measures to ensure ease of access to productive sector facilities that are earmarked for promotion of exports, production, empowerment, and business linkages. This measure is necessary by the need to address concerns raised by both business and individuals on the difficulties confronted in accessing these facilities. It is therefore necessary to ensure that final beneficiaries have easy access to funding for them to expeditiously promote production and exports. Number 9, upward review of threshold for exports by individuals. In order to improve ease of doing business by individuals, going forward, the threshold for value of goods that can be exported by individual without completing export forms has been increased from the current $1,000 to $2,000. But such process will need to be repatriated into the country. No externalization of funds. 10. Upward review of foreign currency threshold retentions by exporters. In recognition of the need to ensure continuous generation of foreign currency, the foreign currency retention threshold for all services and products except gold, diamonds, platinum, chrome, and tobacco remains at 100% of export receipts for exporters' use in their business operations within an extended period of up to 14 days from the date of export of receipt of funds. The retention threshold for privately owned diamond firms, platinum, and the chrome producers has been increased from the current 20% to 35%, whilst that for gold, public owned diamond firms, and tobacco remains at the current level. We are putting more money into the hands of the exporters so that they can do their business and increase more to the country. 11, downward review on export, cost of export documentation. The current charges based on the same control system on exports of non-compliant exporters are high. Given the need to facilitate exports at the same time affording exporters an opportunity to comply with the presidential amnesty on illegally externalized funds, the maximum administrative charge has been reduced from $50 to $20 for export transaction. 12, establishment of an investment desk to cater for the diaspora. There has been increased calls for the establishment of a desk to facilitate Zimbabweans in the diaspora to participate in the development of their country through mobilizing investment into the all sectors of the economy. Already, there has been a positive response to this cause, as evidenced by the numerous inquiries from the diaspora and international investors. Consistent with these tenets of the ease of doing business in an open business environment, the bank has established a desk to assist those in diaspora to get involved in the investment opportunities within the national economy. 13. Issuance of diaspora tobacco and gold production financing bonds. Tobacco and gold contribute significantly to the country's export receipts. The tobacco and gold sectors, if sustainably and adequately funded, have the potential to generate more foreign currency for the economy. The bank has also noted that small and startup companies in the tobacco sector are failing to access offshore funding in line with the tobacco finance order. In order to allow Zimbabweans in the diaspora to participate fully or on a quitting basis in the turnaround of the economy and export generation, the bank has opened the issuance of well-secured tobacco and gold production financing bonds to the diaspora investors. The diaspora tobacco production financing bond will be issued to Zimbabweans in the diaspora to finance tobacco production. Bondholders will be paid capital plus interest as a single blade payment at the end of the tobacco selling season. the diaspora gold production financing bonds will be issued to Zimbabwe in the diaspora to finance gold production by small gold miners. Common payments will be made on a monthly basis as gold is sold to the daily printers and refiners. 14. Incentive for diaspora investments in Zimbabwe. In an effort to facilitate investment, inward investments by Zimbabweans in the diaspora, going forward, Zimbabweans in the diaspora can open diaspora investment accounts with the local banks of their choice. The accounts, which shall be for savings or investment purposes, for holding funds or earmarked for investments, whatever purpose, shall be funded from offshore and shall be entitled to 7% diaspora remittance incentive from the Reserve Bank, over and above the interest offered by the banks. 17, curbing of multi-pricing system and refusal of plastic money by some businesses. Government is putting in place measures to curb the multi-pricing system within the economy. Multi-pricing system and refusal to accept plastic money is counterproductive to the successful and unparalleled efforts achieved so far in the promotion and use of plastic money in Zimbabwe. Business will need to be reminded to show respect to consumers and to exercise self-discipline under the new economic dispensation. It's against this background that the 2018 finance bill, which is now going through Parliament and now awaits approval by the Senate, is making this malpractice of multi-pricing system and refusal of plastic money illegal. 18, strengthening financial credibility. In line with the lending powers of the bank to government to provide for, as provided for in Section 11, Section 1A of the Reserve Bank Act, Chapter 2215, the bank is putting in place measures to ensure that the lending limit government does not exceed the regulated 20% of the previous year's revenue of the state. This measure is necessary to, in order to comply with the good corporate governance and to mitigate the unintended consequences of excess government overdraft on the economy. 19. Strengthening of liquidity management systems. To ensure stability of the monetary system, the bank is strengthening its liquidity management systems to mop RTGS money and make it more attractive for investment, and in so doing, being productive resources. The bank will achieve this through issuance of medium-term government paper to improve monetary policy stance on the economy by signaling and developing a yield curve, which also helps in the development of the local bond market. Already the bank has issued a 7% savings bond, whose uptake has been good at 165 million in 3 months, October to December last year. Further, the reintroduction of the auction system for treasury bills and bonds will bring in transparency as well as allow a discernible yield curve to be developed. The bank is also assessing the possibility of reintroducing open market operation tools during the course of the year in order to deal with excess liquidity in the market. 20, acceptance of 99-year land leases as security by banks. In line with the current economic dispensation's aspiration to transform agriculture into a viable business proposition and taking into account of the significant improvements made by government on the 99-year lease to enhance the security of tenure of the lease and making it bankable and transferable, the bank has agreed with the banking institutions for them to accept the 99-year lease as security for accessing credit from financial institutions in line with the provisions of the list. Point one. What is not on the presidential amnesty on internet forex and assets? Following the announcement by the presidential amnesty on externalized foreign currency and assets by His Excellency the President, the bank is encouraged by the overwhelming response from Zimbabwe desiring to comply with the amnesty arrangement. The responses have been positive from both individuals and corporates in respect of foreign currency and not decommissioned or demonetized local currency. That was externalized by commission or omission or under the liberalized exchange control framework, which with such foreign currency banked offshore or used to acquire foreign assets. The response to date demonstrates the willingness by corporate individuals to comply with these arrangements. Already, the bank deposits have been increasing on account of funds being channeled into the formal banking system as corporates and individuals take heed of the amnesty to repatriate externalized funds and or deposit such funds in the banking system. The bank is offering 7% tax-free savings bonds for funds to be repatriated under the amnesty dispensation where funds were externalized under the auspices of free funds, not illegal transition. It is essential to note that the requirement for the disclosure of foreign assets, as is required by the amnesty, is in compliance with international best practice and is therefore not unique to Zimbabwe. Almost all countries make such disclosures mandatory. In any case, all transactions, all payments need to be bona fide to satisfy KYC and the customer due diligence principles of banking. The amnesty, which pertains to externalized foreign currency and assets bought outside and using foreign currency that belong to Zimbabwe through acts or commissions, as given in the table that we shall give you here, shall show, does not affect funds and assets acquired by Zimbabweans in the diaspora. We are only talking about Zimbabwean money that went out and be invested in both assets, but not money that belong to the diaspora. 22. What is not on the continuation of the multi-currency system? Government's policy stance on currency reform that pertains to the de-dollarization is well documented, as was clearly articulated by His Excellency the President, enforced by the Honorable Minister of Finance. Government is quite aware that the most important economic fundamentals that the country need to achieve before any current reform begins are a healthier foreign exchange buffer, sufficient to cover at least 3 months of imports, and reducing fiscal deficit to sustainable levels as defined in the Reserve Bank of Zimbabwe Act. These fundamentals, which are critical to ensure free convertibility, are still weak and fragile for a currency reform. It is against this reality that the country will continue to use the multi-currency system. In the future, when the economic fundamentals become strong, the roadmap for currency reform in Zimbabwe will be predicated or tailor-made along the currency board and or gold standard mechanisms that are stringent mandatory rules. The two special features of which are high credibility of mandatory authorities and the existence of self-adjustment non-discretional mechanisms. The current board or gold standard systems have a mechanism that links demand and supply of money to the balance of payments position of any country, which is essential for convertibility and for the quick elimination of imbalances within the economy. These systems basically take the form of monetary constitution, which is characterized by a higher level of credibility and confidence. So, what we are saying, simple terms, that the multi-currency system will continue, and that in the future, when the foreign currency buffer is gone up, and when the fiscal deficit is to sustainable levels, the government of Zimbabwe will have a roadmap, which you have just said. We are doing this not to remove confusion in the market, in order to remove whether to use other currencies or neutral currencies. I think it's essential to define the roadmap. 23, holds not on the accelerated areas clearance and the re-engagement program. In line with the new economic order, government is intensifying the re-engagement process with the international community to improve international relations and to resolve the external payments arrears to the remaining international financial institutions, ADB, IMF, EIB, and others, as well as bilateral creditors. It is in this regard, government will follow the previously agreed process for clearing arrears to IFIs, which was endorsed by the national financial institutions and creditors at a meeting held on the sidelines of the annual meetings of IMF and World Bank in Lima, Peru in October 2015. The successful resolution of arrears to IFIs will pave way for government to negotiate debt restructuring mechanisms with the Paris Club. The ensuing improvement in economic activity following successful re-engagement will significantly reduce the country's risk profile and unlock offshore credit lines of credit, because access to foreign finance, which has been significantly limited over the past 17 years, is critical for foreign currency buffer in the country. In addition, we do believe that government will also be in a position to actively engage the donor community once we remove the career clearance to complement government support to targeted social and developmental programs. The envisaged high economic growth rates coming out from after re-engagement will go a long way for the country to sustain appropriate debt levels and increase fiscal space, jobs, production, and exports. These are the 23 measures that we do going to put in place to ensure that Zimbabwe walk the talk of opening up the economy. In conclusion, the narrative open for business means that Zimbabwe is ready and willing to embrace a paradigm shift to attract investors, both local and foreign, for the total transformation of the economy in respect of increased production, jobs, exports, fiscal space, access to capital, and access to foreign finance. Improvement in these economic variables will greatly benefit the monetary environment, and in doing so, enhancing financial stability and confidence within the national economy. A healthy foreign exchange buffer will strengthen the value of RTGS funds and gradually reduce cash shortages. Open for business, not just a narrative. It calls for the dramatic change in the conduct of business from the current business as usual approach we need to walk the talk to rebalance the economy through a tight rein on fiscal deficit, increasing revenue, collections, and holding expenditures constant, whilst at the same time enhancing Zimbabwe's access to foreign finance and increasing foreign direct investment, increasing exports and international remittances.